Hello students, welcome back. Next, now we'll discuss the next topic, memory according to the type of interface. The interface of a memory with the processor or controller can be of various types. It may be a parallel interface or it may be a serial interface. In a parallel interface, the parallel data lines either 8 bit, that is a D0 to D7 for an 8 bit processor or a controller, will be connected to D0 to D7 of the memory. Here the memory density is expressed in terms of kilobytes. And another type of interface, it may be serial interface like I2C, that is a interface controller protocol communication, it is serial communication, pronounced as I2C. It is a two line serial interface. It is a two line only. Here used for data storage memory like EEPROM, memory density of a serial memory is usually expressed in terms of kilobits here. Kilobits. Example, 824C512 is an example for serial memory with a capacity of 512 kilobits and two wire interface. And another one interface also be used is also serial communication, but it is on a synchronous type of communication, that is a SPI, SPI, serial peripheral interface. 2 plus n lines interface is there in this case, where small n is represent the total number of SPI devices are connected, that is a small n indication. Next, memory shadowing. Here RAM access is about 3 times as fast as ROM access, because RAM is on read write memory. This memory we are using for temporary storage purpose during the execution of the program. So that's the why the speed of the RAM must be greater than the access time of the RAM. Here execution time of the RAM is very slow, that is of about 120 to 200 nanosecond, compared to the execution of with RAM memory, it takes 40 to 70 nanosecond. Shadowing of memory is a technique adapted to solve the execution speed problem in processor based systems. In computer system and video system, there will be a configuration holding RAM called a basic input output configuration RAM, or simply we call it as a BIOS. So the BIOS is actually holds the software, which is the detail of the hardware in the system. So here store the hardware configuration information like the address assigned for the various serial ports and other non-plug and play devices, as like your personal computer BIOS booting operation, what it is takes. Similarly, it is that purpose the memory shadowing, this RAM memory is using, that is called as a BIOS. Next here, now the manufacturer include a RAM behind the logical layer of BIOS at its same address as shadow to the BIOS, and the following steps happens. Okay, during the boot up, BIOS is copied to the shadowed RAM. RAM is write protected. BIOS reading is disabled. So these are the some of the steps is involving in the BIOS memory. Why both RAM and ROM are needed for holding the same data? The answer is simple. RAM is volatile, you know that, and it cannot be hold the configuration data which is copied from the BIOS when the power supply is switched off. Only a RAM can hold it permanently. That's why it is copy takes with RAM content to RAM. But for high system performance, it should be accessed from a RAM instead of accessing from RAM. Next, memory selection for the embedded system. Okay, embedded system require what the embedded system it asks, the requirement of the embedded system depending on the memory selection to be take. A program memory for holding the control algorithm or a embedded operating system application. There are program memory, data memory, and simple temporary storage memory. These are the some memories are required. According to your requirement of the embedded system, you need to be select. One is the program memory. It's for holding the control algorithm or a firmware in an embedded OS and applications. Data memory for holding variables and temporary data during task execution, and memory for holding non-volatile data like configuration data, lookup table, etc., which are modifiable by the application. This is the three way or three different purpose the selection of the memory need to be takes. Next, the memory requirement for an embedded system in terms of RAM and ROM. So EEPROM, flash, NVRAM is solely dependent on the type of the embedded system. There is no hard and fast rule for calculating the memory requirements. Lot of factors need to be considered when selecting the type and size of memory for an embedded system. Okay, here take the example. For example, if the embedded system is designed using SoC, SoC means single on chip, or a microcontroller with on chip RAM and ROM, depending on the application need, the on chip memory may be sufficient for designing the total system. As a rule of thumb, identify your system requirement and type of the processor. Okay, these two factors need to be considered for choosing the memory or a requirement of the memory in an embedded system. Example, let us be discuss with taking one example here, electronic die design. As the complexity of requirements are less, data memory requirements are minimal. Okay, because a small die, smaller function, and it requires a less complexity, less design, and also takes data memory also minimal. Think of a microcontroller with a few bytes of internal RAM. A few bytes are kilobytes, depending on the number of tasks and the complexity of the task, of flash memory, and a few bytes of EEPROM if required for designing the system. There is no need for external memory at all, because it's a small memory is enough for the store the required program to for design purpose of the electronic die. A PIC, programmable interface controller, microcontroller is a device which satisfies the input and output memory and requirement can be used in this case. Next, another one example, let consider design based on the RTOS, real time operating system. If a embedded system uses RTOS, what are the requirement of the RAM and ROM will be discussed now. RTOS requires certain amount of RAM for its execution and ROM for storing the RTOS image. Okay, binary code for RTOS kernel containing all the services is stored in a non-volatile memory as either compressed or non-compressed data. During boot of the device, the RTOS files are copied from the program storage memory, decompressed if required, and then loaded to the RAM for execution. The supplier of the RTOS usually gives a rough estimate on the runtime, RAM requirements, and program memory requirements for the RTOS. Okay. Next, on safer side, always add a buffer value to the total estimated RAM and RAM size requirements. Example, a small phone device with a Windows mobile operating system. Suppose 64 MB RAM and 128 MB RAM are the minimum requirements for the running the Windows mobile device. Okay. Indeed, you need extra RAM and ROM for running user applications. So while building the system, count the memory for that also and arrive at a value which is always at the safer side, so that you won't end up in situation where you don't have sufficient memory to install and run user application. And here there are two parameters for representing a memory: size of the memory chip and word size of the memory. Size of the memory chip: the memory chip comes in standard sizes like 512 bytes, 1024 bytes, that we rounded to 1 kilobyte, 2048 bytes, 2 kilobyte, 4 KB, 8 KB, 16, 32, 64, so on, 1024, 1 megabytes, etc. Suppose your embedded application requires only 750 bytes of RAM, you don't have the option for getting a memory chip with a size 750 bytes. The only option left with you to choose the memory chip with a size closer to the size needed. Hence, 1024 byte is the least possible option. Okay. A processor or a controller with a 16-bit address bus can address 2 to the power of 16 is approximately that value 65,535 bytes. Approximately it is rounded to 64 KB. Hence it is meaningless to select a 128 KB memory chip for processor with a 16-bit wide address bus. There are two parameters for representing a memory, that is the size of the memory chip and word of the size of the memory. So here also word size of the memory 4, 8, 12, 16, 24, 32, etc. And in the flash memory is the popular choice of RAM program storage memory in embedded application. It is powerful and cost effective solid state storage technology for mobile electronics devices and other consumer applications. The EEPROM data storage memory is available as either serial interface or parallel interface chip if the processor controller of the device supports serial interface and serial EEPROM chip. So next is a very important topic we'll discuss: sensors and actuators. This will be covers in the next video session. Let me see in the next video session. So I will stop it here. So thank you.